Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bright Galaxies, Dark Matter, and Beyond, The Life of Astronomer Vera Rubin, by Ashley Jean Yeager, narrated by Wendy Tremont King. Prologue. A flip of a switch, and astronomer Vera Rubin disappeared. The darkness of the telescope dome swallowed her hourglass frame as she quickly and confidently took a few steps, grabbed the staircase banister, and climbed up. At the top of the stairs, she slid her hand across the door, found the knob, and pushed. Nothing happened. Like a football lineman, she lowered her center of gravity and threw her weight against the hinged hunk of metal, bumping it open with her hip. A cool gust of air knocked her in the face, and instantly, her eyes flicked upward. She scanned the sky, east to west, as if searching for the faint glow of the galaxies she'd studied over the past 6 decades. Now, on the catwalk of Kitt Peak National Observatory's 2.1-meter telescope, she walked slowly toward a second door, without looking down. Vera savored the silence and the starlight. It was close to 6 in the evening on a cool November night in 2007, and Vera and her longtime collaborator, astronomer Deidre Hunter, were about to awaken the telescope and turn it skyward. They planned to point the huge glass eye at a spiral galaxy called NGC 801 and another called UGC 2885, one of the universe's largest swirls of stars. After one last look at the stars, Vera again disappeared into the darkened telescope dome, crossed it, as she'd done dozens of times before, and walked back to the control room. She removed her hat and gloves, smoothed her cropped white hair, straightened her owl-eyed glasses, and sat down. Faint rumbling began outside as a massive metal garage door slid open, and the telescope's mirror cover was systematically removed, giving the highly reflective glass eye, sheltered inside, its first sight of the sky that night. Then there was silence. Vera and Deidre pushed buttons, flipped through their observing logs and notebooks, and continually checked the telescope. Finally, about 30 minutes later, Vera spoke. "We are getting more distance than I did in 1980. In 1980, Vera and her colleagues had been trying to find stars at the extreme fringes of spiral galaxies and measure those stars' velocities. Those velocities, the speeds at which the stars whip around the galaxy, provide clues about a galaxy's structure and composition. They reveal tantalizing clues about the shape of a galaxy and its heft." Vera had become fascinated with galaxies in graduate school, and about a decade later, in the 1960s, when she started studying the stars and hot gas of our nearest spiral neighbor, Andromeda, she spotted something odd. Nearly all of the galaxy's stars and gas traveled around the spiral's core at roughly the same speeds. The stars and hot gas sitting far from the spiral center were moving much faster than she expected. Vera wasn't sure what to make of what she saw. The data seemed to defy the laws of physics. That's because astronomers had thought a galaxy's stars and gas would swing around the spiral just the way planets circle the sun. The closest objects move the fastest, while the ones farthest from the star's gravitational grip move more slowly. a spiral galaxy's stars, many astronomers assumed, should behave similarly, with the stars closer to the galaxy's core traveling much faster than the stars farther out. But that wasn't what Vera saw. Instead, Andromeda's outermost stars moved around the galaxy just as quickly as the stars closer to its core. Very unusual behavior. Vera wasn't the only person who saw that stars and gas in galaxies didn't behave the way astronomers had expected. Radio astronomers, who studied the heavens in radio wavelengths, were also observing faster-than-expected speeds for galaxies' gas. Nature seemed to demand that astronomers rethink the content of the cosmos. To explain the swift speeds of stars and gas that Vera and others had observed, the universe would need more matter. Astronomers didn't know what it was or really where it was, but the speedy stars and gas suggested that some form of additional matter did in fact exist. This extra matter was called dark matter, a nod to astronomers in the 1920s and 1930s, who first noticed that stars in galaxies and galaxies in clusters didn't move at the speeds Isaac Newton's law of gravity predicted. They moved much faster. To explain the fast speeds of stars in the Milky Way, Dutch astronomer Jan Oort, in the 1920s, had suggested that our galaxy might have dark matter tugging them along. A few years later, an astronomer at Caltech, Fritz Zwicky, also suggested that galaxies needed extra mass. Without it, the Coma Cluster, a clutch of more than 1,000 galaxies, sitting some 322 million light-years from Earth, should fly apart. Yet that wasn't what astronomers saw. Instead, the galaxies in the cluster stuck together. Around that same time as World War II loomed, Horace Babcock, a graduate student at the University of California, Berkeley, also made observations that hinted at the existence of dark matter. He showed that Andromeda, which Vera would study decades later, might need some extra matter, again, to explain the fast speeds of stars circling the galaxy's center. The universe, the studies seemed to suggest, wasn't what it seemed. The universe needed more matter. Those clues, pointing to the need for additional matter to exist, failed to capture astronomers' attention. And so, the hints that dark matter existed went unheeded. More evidence for dark matter emerged again in the 1950s and 1960s. From radio astronomers. Then, Vera came along, and drawing on Oort's work, calculated that the Milky Way's stars seemed to move too fast for Newton's law of gravity. When she and Kent Ford pointed a telescope at Andromeda, they saw the same thing. So did radio astronomer Mort Roberts, while Seth Shostak, a graduate student at Caltech, and his PhD advisor, David Rogstad, also spotted gas moving too fast in a few other galaxies. Shostak even took a crack at explaining the fast gas, positing in 1971 that the galaxies he studied had to contain some form of invisible matter. Collectively, the radio and Vera's optical observations captured theorists' attention, leading them to run computer simulations that showed that for galaxies to develop their spiral shape, they did have to have matter we could not see. Specifically, they had to have a halo or cloak of subluminal matter, matter so faint our telescopes at the time couldn't detect it. And there was more. The simulations said there had to be 10 times more subluminal matter than observable matter for galaxies to take their spiral shape. The case for the existence of invisible matter was beginning to grow. Yet, some astronomers still had their doubts. They questioned the radio astronomer's data, and they questioned Vera's too. And so, Vera and Kent went back to the telescope, as did the radio astronomers. And again and again, she and the others found the same thing. The stars and gas in galaxies were moving too fast to follow Newton's law of gravity. Even still, astronomers had doubts. They were being asked to believe in something they could not see, an exceedingly hard sell for scientists. And they were being asked to overturn an assumption about galaxies that they'd held for decades. Again, no easy feat. Vera hated scientific assumptions. She looked for every opportunity to invalidate them. She did, however, have a few personal presumptions that she used to navigate her life and her research, ones that drove her to test some of the long-held conventions of the astronomy community, conventions propagated mainly by men. Vera's presumptions were that half the brains of the world belong to women. Women could solve a scientific problem just as well as any man, and we all need permission to do science, women especially so. She had the brains. She probed questions about the cosmos few else would. She could solve exceedingly complex problems. And she'd earned astronomers' permission to do so. So she resolutely set to the task of testing astronomers' assumptions about how stars and gas move around galaxies. Vera decided she'd look at dozens of galaxies to see if the stars and gas behaved similarly to what astronomers expected, or if the stars and gas in those galaxies defied assumptions. In 10, then 20, then 40, then 60 galaxies, she and Kent found stars that moved too fast to follow Newton's law of gravity. Her work defied astronomers' assumptions about galaxies and their stars and gas. Slowly, the astronomy community began to acknowledge that there had to be more to the universe than meets the eye. By 1980, when Vera was at the telescope pushing to find the farthest young stars in UGC 2885, a consensus was beginning to emerge about her work. The data were all but undeniable. "All you had to do was look at the data," she said, "and you could see that the speeds of stars and gas stayed steady, even farther and farther from a galaxy's core." The unexpected speeds demanded an explanation. They could be explained, astronomers finally conceded, if galaxies had large amounts of matter we cannot see, dark matter. It was Vera's perseverance that finally helped to convince the scientific community of the existence of dark matter. Her work was pivotal to redefining the composition of our cosmos, revealing that most of it is some mysterious form of matter that even today we do not understand. 1. Stellar Tales. 11-year-old Vera Rubin, Vera Cooper then, stared at an imaginary line running down the bed she shared with her sister Ruth, then rolled over defeated. She was the younger of the two and was told she couldn't sleep next to the small row of windows that lined the inner wall of the bedroom and fortuitously faced north. But even from the inside edge, the starlight caught Vera's attention. She was mesmerized. Every night, she'd crawl over Ruth to get a better view of the sky. "I was very angry at her," Ruth said, "because she'd wake me up." But Vera couldn't help it. "There was just nothing as interesting in my life," she said, "as watching the stars." Vera and her family had recently moved into a rented 3-bedroom townhouse in Northwest Washington, D.C. At first, she and Ruth had separate rooms, but soon the family decided they wanted a den, so they converted Vera's room into that shared space. Vera moved in with Ruth, a move that ultimately spurred Vera's love of the stars, much to her sister's dismay, at least back then. Vera was born Vera Florence Cooper on July 23, 1928, at Temple University Hospital in Philadelphia, to Rose Applebaum Cooper and Philip Cooper. Philip, an emigrant from Poland, was born just before the turn of the 20th century as Pesach Koszewski in the town of Vilna, now the capital of Lithuania. Philip's father was in the leather business, and around 1905, he moved to Gloversville, New York, to establish himself in the United States before sending for his family a year later. Philip, who quickly became known as Pete, had an older sister and 2 younger brothers. All of them lived a comfortable life in upstate New York, where the family stayed until Pete was a junior in high school. Then, leaving him behind to finish his schooling, the family moved to West Philadelphia to open a store where they sold leather goods, such as ladies' gloves, and to set up a leather tannery. Pete joined his family in Philadelphia a year later after finishing high school and enrolled at the University of Pennsylvania, probably the first person in his family to go to college. Vera said he was awfully smart. He was very talented mathematically, and there was never any question about whether he would go to college. It was certain he would. Vera's mother's family also emigrated to the United States just before the turn of the 20th century. Her grandmother left an apple orchard in Bessarabia, in what is now Moldova and part of Ukraine, to travel to Pennsylvania, according to the stories she told her grandchildren. She enthralled us as children with tales of her crossing the ocean, essentially in steerage, and not eating because the food wouldn't be kosher, Vera said. Her grandmother nearly starved on her voyage to America, and probably survived only because one of the ship's officers regularly brought her fruit. She arrived in Philadelphia, I think at about the age of 16, and within a few years had married someone who had also come from near where she had come from. He was a tailor. He hand-sewed and finished things for John Wanamaker, a famous American merchant, Vera explained. Her mother, Rose, was born in 1900, grew up in Philadelphia, and attended William Penn High School. She had a very beautiful singing voice, and she said that she was always embarrassed by being asked to sing. So, she eventually took lessons from Giuseppe Bugatti, a famous tenor. Bugatti not only worked with Rose at the time, but also with Marian Anderson, whom Rose had gone to school with, and whose voice would be one that would set the stage for the civil rights movement. It was during this period, the early decades of the 1900s, when Vera's grandparents were settling in the United States and her parents were reaching adulthood, that astronomers had begun to explore the idea that the universe might not be exactly as it seemed. Those scientific ideas weren't center stage for Vera's family then. After Rose graduated from high school, she took a job with the Bell Telephone Company. Pete was working at the company too as an engineer, and so the two met at work and were also introduced through mutual friends. Their relationship progressed relatively quickly, so much so that they had to keep it a secret, because Bell had a no-dating policy among co-workers. But that policy didn't prevent Rose and Pete from eventually getting married. It just meant that Rose would quit her job, partly because of the no-dating policy and partly because the couple was about to start a family. They bought a house in Mount Airy, a suburb of Philadelphia, and had their first child, Ruth, on March 29, 1926. A little over 2 years later, Vera was born. By this time, a few prominent astronomers, such as Jan Oort, were calculating how much unseen mass might fill the Milky Way. And a few years later, Fritz Zwicky started contemplating the speeds of galaxies in the Coma Cluster. Pete, Vera's father, was growing restless with his job at Bell, and apparently told his boss or another superior that he was bored, to which his superior responded, "That's the trouble with you Jewish boys." The supervisor told Pete the company was developing a laboratory, Bell Labs, and had planned to send him there. But he was too impatient to wait, Vera said, so he quit. By 1932 or 1933, he was out of work, and Vera recalled, at the age of 4 or 5, her parents shut the door on their Mount Airy home and never returned. They could not afford the payments. The Coopers moved in with Pete's parents, who still owned the leather store and tannery in Philly, and Pete went to work in the laundry supply business with his brother-in-law. On weekends in the summer, Pete would take Vera and Ruth out to the country in his laundry supply truck, a special treat for Vera. Despite its being the later years of the Great Depression, Vera said that her home life was incredibly pleasant. My parents were enormously in love, and they really had a wonderful life. My father was devoted to my sister and me, and my mother was too. Vera and Ruth's parents had support from both sets of the children's grandparents as well, and they were always filling the kitchen with the aromas of heavenly cooking. Both girls took piano lessons, and their parents encouraged them to explore the world beyond their grandparents' home. Vera, for example, recalled that at an early age, her parents took her to the Morse School of Engineering at the University of Pennsylvania, where there must have been an accelerator, a little Van de Graaff or something. It was basically a metal globe set atop an insulated stand, and the device used a moving belt to gather electric charge on the globe. We held hands, and our hair stood on end, and blue sparks came out. I remember that with great enthusiasm, she said. Those adventures, she explained, might have been her parents' attempt to compensate for the fact that her grandparents' home, where she lived from age 6 to roughly 10, was not child-friendly. There weren't children's books or toys. There were my father's college books, I remember, and my uncles were certainly very literate, and there were things around, but not really for children, Vera said. Perhaps sensing this lack of engagement for his daughters, Pete built them a dollhouse. He had gotten the plans from Good Housekeeping magazine, and board by board, he constructed an elaborate colonial mansion, complete with working lights and a working radio. It was a delight for Vera and Ruth to play with, a deeply cherished family toy. Ruth and Vera also loved listening to college football games on the radio, and when they were not playing with the dollhouse or taking in the play-by-play of a game, Vera often went to the Franklin Institute, a science museum in downtown Philadelphia. "I did sort of fall in love with the Franklin Institute," she said. "They had these cones that you put sand in, and they were suspended on chains from the ceiling. As they moved, the cones made lissajou figures, graphic curves that describe harmonic motion, that got smaller and smaller. I could have spent a day in front of those," she said. "The Institute also had a very large kaleidoscope that you actually walked into. It had mirrors on all sides and lights coming in, and I got very interested in kaleidoscopes." But just as Vera was starting to explore the delights of the Franklin Institute, the family moved. Pete had taken a job overseeing construction of a state facility in central Pennsylvania. After years of sharing a home with their parents, the Coopers relocated to Seelands Grove, a borough northwest of Philadelphia, nestled along the Susquehanna River. They rented a home from a college professor who usually worked at the Susquehanna University but was on sabbatical. There, at that house, in the attic, Vera found a set of Book of Knowledge encyclopedias. She had not had books like that at her grandparents' house, and so she was delighted to delve into them, recalling that from them she learned to press flowers in sand and possibly to build a kaleidoscope. "I made a kaleidoscope out of my mother's icing squeezer," she said. She screwed wax paper with little pieces of material onto the front of the aluminum icing cylinder, then cut three pieces of glass to make the optical part of the device. It was the start of her tinkering with lenses and light. The Coopers stayed 6 months in Seelands Grove. Then Pete was offered a job at the Department of Agriculture in Washington, D.C., and the family moved again when Vera was 10. It was 1938. For the first few months in the city, she attended H.D. Cook Elementary School near the Adams Morgan neighborhood, where she and her classmates worked in groups studying different subjects, rather than sitting in desks, just listening to a teacher. "We studied South America. We made an enormous relief map, and we electrified it and put little lights in places and strings up to the board behind it and identified things. I had never done anything like that in school," she said. "It was just phenomenal. I just loved every minute of it. And I think, about that time, I decided I was going to be a kindergarten teacher because I liked all the cutting and the pasting and the making." Not long after moving, the Coopers relocated north to a townhouse on Tuckerman Street near Tacoma Park, where Vera looked out the windows along the wall of her shared bedroom and became captivated by the stars. Eager to learn more about science and the night sky, she went to the local library, where she read about great science legends of the past, Isaac Newton, Benjamin Franklin, and Franklin's cousin Maria Mitchell, whose story fascinated Vera because of the thrilling astronomical discoveries she made and because she was a woman. Born in Nantucket in 1818, Mitchell was raised a Quaker, a religion that promoted, even then, that girls and boys deserve an equal opportunity to education. Mitchell attended several schools and was also tutored by her father, a public school teacher interested in astronomy and mathematics. At the time, women were encouraged to study science, and Mitchell's father, William, noticed that Maria had a knack for mathematics. So he had her help him with his surveying and navigation calculations. At age 12, Maria helped her father observe a solar eclipse and used the data to calculate the location of the family's home. Vera was inspired. That was roughly the age she was when she started watching the stars. A few years later, Maria started to help sailors calculate coordinates for their whaling expeditions. And at age 16, she opened her own school in Nantucket, accepting both black and white students, a controversial decision in the 1830s, but one about which she was adamant. Maria went on to become the first librarian at the Nantucket Athenaeum, and it was while she was working there and helping her father in the evenings with his observations of the night sky that she strode, accidentally, into the professional astronomy world. On the night of October 1, 1847, Maria scanned the sky with a 3-inch telescope from the roof of the Pacific National Bank, where her father worked, and spotted a fuzzy blob that didn't appear in any of her astronomical logs. Observing the object closely and tracking its motion, she realized the spot probably wasn't a planet or a star, but something more transitory, perhaps a comet. That thrill of Maria Mitchell's discovery, that instant in which she saw something no one else had seen, captivated Vera, making her wonder whether she'd discover something so awe-inspiring as a comet from her studies of the stars. As Vera read more on the discovery, she found Maria's excitement for the night sky encouraging. And so too was the lesson she shared on surrounding yourself with individuals who would champion your passion, not quash it. That became clear when Vera learned what happened right after Maria spotted her unusual orb. Maria rushed to tell her father, and he told her that she should write a summary of her work and send it off to other astronomers to announce her discovery. But Maria was hesitant. She didn't think the scientific community would recognize her work. Her father disagreed. Determined that his daughter earned the recognition she deserved, William wrote to his friends and colleagues in the astronomy community. These were influential individuals, such as William C. Bond, the director of the observatory at Harvard. At her father's colleagues' urging, Maria eventually wrote a short description of her discovery, submitting it in January 1848 under her father's name to Silliman's Journal, a U.S.-based publication. The next month, she submitted a second description, a calculation of the comet's orbit, a publication that would ensure she was given credit as the comet's original discoverer. Impressed by the work, Harvard's president at the time, Edward Everett, suggested that Maria apply for a gold medal from the Danish king for her discovery. In the early 1830s, Frederick VI, an amateur astronomer and king of Denmark, had announced that he would award a gold medal prize to the first astronomer to use a telescope to spot a comet, too faint to be seen with the naked eye. Frederick VI died in 1839 after he had made the proclamation, but his successor and son, Christian VIII, chose to honor his father's wishes. On October 3, 1847, 2 days after Maria's discovery, Francesco di Vico independently observed the same comet as Maria and immediately reported it to European authorities. Since word of Maria's discovery hadn't yet reached Europe, the comet was named after De Vico, and he was awarded the Danes' gold medal for the comet's discovery. When word of Maria Mitchell's discovery finally reached the king, however, he had to choose whether to award her a medal. Frederick VI's original proclamation had said he would award the medal to the first discoverer of each newly identified comet. But Christian VIII had already awarded the medal for Maria's comet to De Vico. King Christian ultimately chose to award Maria the medal, and he allowed DeVico to keep his, a decision that made Maria Mitchell famous, as the comet she discovered became known as Miss Mitchell's Comet. With her discovery, she joined the ranks of Caroline Herschel and Maria Margareta Kirch, the only two other female astronomers to find comets. Maria Mitchell's work, however, did more than put her in the ranks of Herschel and Kirch. It also changed European astronomers' perception of American astronomy. They could no longer snub the discoveries made across the Atlantic. Maria Mitchell's success didn't cease with her discovery of a comet. It, along with her subsequent observations, as well as her teaching prowess, earned her the first faculty appointment at Vassar College when the school opened in the 1860s. She was named Professor of Astronomy and also the director of the Vassar College Observatory, and she took her work there very seriously, hoping to invigorate the minds of the women she taught no matter the future path they chose. When we are chafed and fretted by small cares, she supposedly told her students, a look at the stars will show us the littleness of our own interests. Maria's story stuck with Vera, especially the idea that watching the stars could become a career, and that Vassar had an observatory and astronomy classes. The story, along with her nightly study of the stars, helped to shape her career aspirations. As soon as I got interested in astronomy, I just decided that's what I was going to do for the rest of my life, she said. I mean, how can you be here with these things, the stars and planets around, and not know about them? Vera's parents weren't oblivious to their daughter's fascination with the stars, and they encouraged it most of the time. The late-night observing wasn't so well received, and Vera's mother once called to her as she left, Vera, don't spend the whole night with your head out the window. Vera didn't always listen. She would sit up late into the night, memorizing the motion of the stars as they moved across the sky. In the morning, she would draw from memory where the stars had traveled, and then she'd talk about what she saw. Vera also tried to surround herself with more people who encouraged her passion for the stars. One woman who indulged Vera's rapture with the night sky was Goldie Back, one of her mother's friends. Vera said that Goldie was one of the most influential women in her life. Goldie had wanted to be an engineer, though the University of Pennsylvania would not permit her to study the subject. So she earned a teaching degree instead and moved to Washington to work at the Bureau of Standards. There she met and later married Michael Goldberg, and the two, Vera recalled, lived a very academic lifestyle. They traveled to conferences and lectures, and they had a convertible, and would take Ruth and Vera out into Virginia, where they could clearly see the stars. On those nights, the Goldbergs pointed out constellations. But Vera reiterated that she wasn't as interested in the mythological outlines that the stars made as much as she was in tracing the stars' motions. That fascination with the stars, not the constellations, might have seemed trivial at the time, but it was significant in the grand scheme of Vera's work, paralleling the way Albert Einstein, at a similarly young age, had imagined thought experiments that would later lay the foundation for special relativity. To aid her studies of the stars and their motions, Vera decided she'd build a telescope. One day, she traveled alone to downtown Washington, D.C., where she picked up this free cardboard tube that linoleum came in and brought it home on the bus. She bought a 2-inch lens from Edmund, a discount optical supply company, and with her father's help, she put together her tool to better study the stars. Vera's father constantly indulged his daughter in these intellectual pursuits. In fact, anything she needed to quench her curiosity for the world, her father would help her get or do. He had a very analytical way of looking at things, and I enjoyed that very much, she said. I think that was a very large influence. Aligned with his relentless will to help his daughter learn, Vera's father took her to the local amateur astronomy club meetings. She had wanted to join on her own, but Pete wouldn't allow it. He thought she was too young. So he joined and took her to the gatherings to listen to talks by notable astronomers, such as the Harvard College Observatory director, Harlow Shapley. In the late 1910s, Shapley famously repositioned the location of the sun in our galaxy, moving it farther out from the Milky Way's center. He also argued that there were no astronomical objects outside our galaxy, that the Milky Way was the entire universe. The Mount Wilson astronomer Edwin Hubble proved Shapley wrong in the 1920s. And so Shapley began to map galaxies, studying how they clustered together and were distributed around our own galaxy. It was this work, which he might have mentioned in his talks, that drove others to study the stars in our galaxy and galaxies in clusters, and sparked the thought that the universe may have more matter than we can see. 2. Dark Matter's Debut. As Vera peered out the window night after night, watching stars swing across the sky, astronomers were slowly becoming aware of the existence of dark matter, though they didn't really know it then. The idea of some unseen substance was so strange, so foreign, that it would need someone like Vera, through the special way she formulated her research, to champion dark matter's existence. So, at first, the idea that it was out there in the universe was largely ignored. An inkling that it might exist cropped up in the 1920s in Dutch astronomer Jan Oort's study of the Milky Way, and then emerged again a few years later in a seemingly wild idea posited by Fritz Zwicky. A bit of a notoriously irascible genius at Caltech, Zwicky was studying a group of 8 galaxies, which were part of the Coma Cluster, in the early 1930s, when he noticed that they didn't behave the way Newton's law of gravitation suggested they should. They were moving too fast. To explain the galaxy's swift velocities, he reasoned that they had to have large amounts of unseen mass, which would give them a gravitational grip that kept the distinct cities of stars neatly tucked together. Without this invisible matter's gravity, Zwicky surmised, the speedy galaxies would have been zipping out of the cluster altogether. But they weren't. An observation that led him to conclude that the cluster must contain what he called dunkle materia, dark matter. Zwicky's use of the term in 1933, when Vera was just 5 years old, has often been cited as the first mention of dark matter in a scientific paper. But it is not. The moniker had been introduced into the scientific literature years before, though it is fair to say now that Zwicky was onto something with his claim of a mysterious mass influencing the movements of the galaxies. Many astronomers, including Vera, would not recognize the significance of Zwicky's work for several decades. Why? Because it's hard to believe in something we can't physically see. The debate about unseeable stuff in the universe is centuries old. In fact, humans were speculating about whether there was more to the universe than meets the eye, possibly as early as the 5th century BCE. That's around the time the philosopher Philolaus hypothesized that a planet, counter to our own, called Antikython, orbited an unseen central fire opposite Earth. And Philolaus wasn't alone in his thinking. The atomists, who argued that all matter was made of atoms, infinitely numerous, indivisible building blocks that existed in endless space, also argued that the universe contained an infinite number of unseen worlds. Aristotle disagreed. His model of the universe countered the atomists' view, placing Earth at the center of a cosmos that did not change. And so, he said, unobservable matter did not exist. His depiction of the Earth-centric universe dominated cosmology in the Western world for centuries, at least until Nicholas Copernicus's notion that the sun, not the Earth, was at the center of the cosmos caught on. Around that time, Giordano Bruno also dared to argue that other worlds did exist, that the stars in the sky were distant suns orbited by their own planets, and that the universe was infinite, with no center. The existence of unseen celestial objects seemed to be a bit of a game of ping-pong back then. Galileo Galilei would change that. Pointing his telescope to the sky in the early 1600s, he was perhaps the first to show that celestial bodies, imperceptible to the human eye, did in fact exist. His work ultimately revealed that the universe was a physical construct, not merely a philosophical idea. Eyeing the night sky through his telescope, he revealed previously unseen moons orbiting Jupiter, and an uncountable number of stars comprising the galaxy's milky appearance. Galileo's observations showed that the universe may contain matter that cannot be perceived by ordinary means, and that the introduction of new technology can reveal to us forms of matter that had previously been invisible. Astrophysicist Gianfranco Bertone and cosmologist Dan Hooper wrote in a 2018 review of the history of dark matter. The telescope was not the only tool astronomers used to detect the existence of objects in the night sky. Another was Isaac Newton's laws of motion and his law of gravitation. In 1783, John Michell used Newton's laws to reason that if gravity applied to light, there could be massive, unseen objects in the universe with so much gravitational tug that even light could not escape them. It was the first notion of the objects we now call black holes. About a decade later, Pierre-Simon Laplace came to a similar conclusion, suggesting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.